ignorance, avihya. Let us now deal with the 12 actors of the Patthikasamuppada, one by one, in due order. The first point for discussion is avihya, Sanskrit, avidya, ignorance. Moha, delusion, and anana, non-knowledge, are synonyms for avihya. What is avihya? It is the non-knowledge of the Supreme Enlightenment. In other words, not knowing the Four Noble Truths. It is also not knowing dependent origination. Owing to this nescience, the uninstructed worldling entertains wrong views. He regards the impermanent as permanent, the painful as pleasant, the soulless as soul, the godless as God, the impure as pure, and the unreal as real. Further, avihya is the non-perception of the conglomerate nature of the five aggregates, pancakandha or mind and body. Ignorance or delusion is one of the root causes of all unwholesome actions, all moral defilements, akusala. All conceivable wrong notions are the result of ignorance. Independently of this crowning corruption, no evil action, whether mental, verbal or physical, could be performed. That is why ignorance is enumerated as the first link of the chain of the 12-fold Patthikasamuppada. Nevertheless, ignorance should not be regarded as a prima causa, a first beginning, or an ultimate origin of things. It is certainly not the first cause. There is no conception of a first cause in Buddhist thought. The doctrine of Patthikasamuppada can be illustrated by a circle, for it is the cycle of existence, bhavakaka. In a circle, any given point may be taken as the starting point. Each and every factor of the Patthikasamuppada can be joined together with another of the series, and therefore no single factor can stand by itself or function independently of the rest. All are interdependent and inseparable. Nothing is independent, or isolated. Dependent origination is an unbroken process. In this process, nothing is stable or fixed, but all is in a whirl. It is the arising of ever-changing conditions dependent on similar evanescent conditions. Here there is neither absolute non-existence nor absolute existence, only bare phenomena roll on, sudadhamma pavatanti. Ignorance, the first factor of the series, therefore, is not the sole condition for volitional formations, the second factor, sankhara. A tripod, for instance, is supported by its three legs. It stands upright because of the interdependence of the legs. If one gives way, the other two fall to the ground unsupported. So, too, the factors of this Patthikasamuppada support one another in various ways. Two volitional formations, sankhara. Avihyapakaya sankhara, dependent on ignorance, arise rebirth producing volitional formations. The term sankhara has also another meaning. In the statement, sab sankhara anixa or anixa vata sankhara, all compounded things are impermanent, the term sankhara applies to all compounded and conditioned things, i.e., all things that come into being as the effect of causes and conditions and which themselves act as causes and conditions in turn to give rise to other effects. In the Patthikasamuppada, however, sankhara is restricted to mean simply all good and evil actions, kusala akusala kama, all actions, physical, verbal and mental, kaya sankhara, vachi sankhara, and citta sankhara, which will bring about reactions. It is difficult to give a satisfactory English equivalent to the term sankhara. Let us, therefore, understand it in this context as rebirth-producing volitional activities, or volitional formations, or simply as kama. Ignorance, avihya, which has taken root in man is the blindness that prevents a man from seeing his actions as they really are, and so allows craving to drive him on to further actions. If there were no ignorance, there would be no such actions. In the absence of actions conditioned by ignorance, there will be no rebirth, and the whole mass of suffering will cease. In order to exemplify how the 12 factors of the Patthikasamuppada act upon a connected sequence of lives, the formula has been conceived as extending over three consecutive existences past, present, and future. Ignorance and volitional formations belong to the previous birth. Wholesome sankharas are capable of bringing about a good rebirth, i.e., birth in a good state of existence. Unwholesome sankharas can cause a bad rebirth or birth in an evil state of existence. It must be mentioned that all sankharas, all good and evil actions, have ignorance as condition. Here a question may be raised as to how actions conditioned by ignorance could bring about good rebirth. All attainment of good, kusala, from the state of virtuous worldling, kalyanapathajayana, and the lesser stream winner, kilasotapanna, to that of the consummate one, arahat, is due to the balance of insight over delusion and of detachment over craving. Good actions are the direct consequence of whatever clear understanding there may be in the doer. It is not because of delusion and craving that a man gives up killing, etc. But because he has the wisdom to see the evil consequences of such actions and also because he is moved by such qualities as compassion and virtue. It is not possible, except for the perfect ones, to act from complete insight or detachment. To the generality of men such knowledge is unthinkable. As Eddington says, if to know means to be quite certain of, the term is of little use to those who wish to be undogmatic. 14. And if to be detached means to be neutral always, such detachment is for the imperfect quite impossible and meaningless. But occasional detachment is possible, and a measure of knowledge adequate for understanding the good is available for an intelligent man of virtue. For producing actions that are wise and unsoiled by the yearning for rewards in this life. There is much that is done in the world today with no hope of reward, or recognition, out of compassion or for the furtherance of knowledge and peace. Such actions definitely are based on knowledge and detachment, not perhaps in the dogmatic, scholastic, or merely metaphysical sense, but in the light of sane, undogmatic thought. Good actions may well have ulterior motives, for instance, the yearning for the fruits of the good, but even in such instances, though tainted by greed and to that extent by delusion, there are in such good actions, for instance in liberality, the detachment to let go and the knowledge of seeing the evils of not giving at all, and the advantage of giving. The presence of craving and ignorance in a person does not mean that he can never act with insight and detachment. Now it must also be understood that although man is capable of performing good actions unsoiled by strong desire for rewards in this life, there may be in him, unconsciously working, a tender longing for good rebirth, or a feeling of desire for rewards in the hereafter. Again, though he may be doing an action out of compassion and without any ulterior motives, he may still be lacking in full awareness of the real nature of life, its being impermanent, sorrow-stricken, and void of an abiding entity or soul. This non-knowledge of the real nature of life, though not so gross and strong as the delusion that induces a heinous act, can yet induce comically wholesome action leading to a good rebirth. A good rebirth even in the heavens, is, however, temporary, and may be followed immediately by an unhappy rebirth. Such non-knowledge motivates and colors the good act. If, for instance, the performance of good actions is motivated by the desire for the resultant happiness in a good rebirth in a heavenly realm, or on earth, then that is the ignorance of the impermanence and unsatisfactory nature of all existence, which becomes a condition of good rebirth, i.e., an inducement or support condition, upanisaya pakaya. In these, and other ways, ignorance may act as a condition of good rebirth by motivating or coloring good volitional activities, sankhara, of a mundane, lokiya, nature. Such is the intrinsic nature of ignorance. Ignorance of the real nature of life is primarily the ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. It is because of this non-knowledge of the truths that beings take birth again and again. Says the Buddha. Monks, it is through not understanding, not penetrating the Four Noble Truths that we have run so long, wandered on so long in this long, long way, both you and I. But when these Four Noble Truths are understood and penetrated, rooted out is the craving for existence, destroyed is that which leads to renewed becoming, and there is no more coming to be. 15. Only the actions of one who has entirely eradicated all the latent tendencies, anasya, and all the varied ramifications of sorrow's cause, are incapable of producing rebirth. For such actions are issueless. He is the arahat, consummate one, whose clarity of vision, whose depth of insight penetrates into the deepest recesses of life. In whom craving has quite ceased through cognizing the true nature that underlies all appearance. He has transcended all appearance. He has transcended all capacity for error through the perfect immunity which penetrative insight, vipassana, alone can give. He is, therefore, released from ignorance, avihya, and his actions no more bring about rebirth. 3. Consciousness, vinana. Sankarapakaya vinanam, dependent on rebirth producing volitional formations, belonging to the previous birth, arises consciousness, relinking or rebirth consciousness, dot. To express it in another way, dependent on the kamma or good and evil actions of the past, is conditioned the conscious life in this present birth. Consciousness, therefore, is the first factor, nidana, or first of the conditioning links belonging to the present existence. Avihya and sankhara, ignorance and volitional formations belonging to the past, together produce vinana, consciousness in this birth. We read in the Mahanidana Sutta of the Dinghanikaya, how once ignorance and craving are destroyed, good and evil actions no more come into being, consequently no more rebirth consciousness will spring up again in a mother's womb. Hence it is clear that rebirth is caused by one's own good and evil actions, and is not work of a supreme being, a creator God, nor is it due to mere chance. As this consciousness or vinana is the first in the stream of consciousness, siddhasantati, belonging to one single existence, bhava, it is also known as padasandhi vinana, relinking consciousness. The term padasandhi literally means relinking, reuniting, rejoining. It is rebirth, re-entry into the womb. Rebirth is the arising, the coming to be, the being born, in the future, padasandhiti ayatima upadi. It is called reuniting because of its linking back the new existence to the old, bhavantara padasandhanato padasandhiti vukati. The joining of the new to the old is the function of reuniting or relinking. Therefore, it is said, the function of reuniting is the joining together of, one, existence with, another, existence, bhavato bhavasa padasandhanam padasandhi kikam. Padasandhi vinana is the kamma resultant consciousness, vipaka vinana, present at rebirth, connecting the new existence with the immediately preceding one. And through that with the entire past of the being reborn. This resultant consciousness is due to previous rebirth producing volitional formations, sankhara or kamma. In the Ananjasapaya Sutta, 16, the vipaka vinana is referred to as samvatanakam vinanam, the consciousness that links on, that proceeds in one life as vipaka from the kamma in the former life. When it is said, the consciousness that links on, it does not mean that this consciousness abides unchanged. Continues in the same state without perishing throughout this cycle of existence. Consciousness is also conditioned, and therefore is not permanent. Consciousness also comes into being and passes away, yielding place to new consciousness. Thus this perpetual stream of consciousness goes on until existence ceases. Existence in a way is consciousness. In the absence of consciousness no being exists in this sentient world. In the Buddhist doctrine of rebirth the third factor required for rebirth, the Gandhaba, is called the rebirth consciousness, which is another term for the padasandhi vinana, relinking consciousness. 17. There is the last moment of consciousness, kudisiddha, belonging to the immediately previous life. Immediately following the cessation of that consciousness there arises the first moment of consciousness of the present birth, which as stated above, is termed relinking consciousness, padasandhi vinana. Between these two moments of consciousness, however, there is no interval, there is no antarabhava or antarabhavasada, which means either a being in the womb or a being in between the state of death and that of rebirth, as some of the Mahayana schools of thought maintain, asti antarbhava. 18. It should be clearly understood that this relinging consciousness is not a self or a soul or an ego entity that experiences the fruits, vipaka, of good and evil deeds. The Mahatanhasankhaya Sutta records the following incident. During the time of the Buddha there was a monk called Sati who held the following view, insofar as I understand the Dhamma taught by the Buddha. It is the same consciousness that transmigrates and wanders about, in rebirth. The monks who heard of this tried to dissuade Sati, saying, "Do not, brother Sati, speak thus, do not misrepresent the Lord, neither is misrepresentation of the Lord proper, nor would the Lord speak thus. For, brother Sati, in many a figure is dependent origination spoken of in connection with consciousness by the Lord, saying, apart from condition there is no origination of consciousness." But Sati would not change his view. Thereupon the monks reported the matter to the Buddha, who summoning him, spoke to him thus. "Is it true, as is said, that a pernicious view like this has arisen in you, Sati? In so far as I understand the Dhamma taught by the Lord, it is this consciousness itself that runs on, fares on, not another. Even so do I, Lord, understand the Dhamma taught by the Lord, it is this consciousness itself that runs on, fares on, not another. What is this consciousness, Sati? It is that which expresses, which feels, Vedo Vidyo, and experiences the result of good and evil deeds now here, now there. But to whom, foolish man, have you heard me teaching the Dhamma in this way? Have I not in many ways explained consciousness as arising out of conditions, that apart from conditions there is no arising of consciousness? But now you, foolish man, misrepresent me because of your own wrong grasp." 19. The Buddha then explained the different types of consciousness and made clear, by means of examples, how consciousness arises depending on conditions. In the words of the Buddha, the Patthikasamuppada is a very deep and intricate doctrine, and in this difficult doctrine the most subtle and deep point. Difficult to grasp, is this third link, consciousness, vinana or patisandhi vinana, for it is this link that explains rebirth. 4. Mentality materiality, namarupa. Vinana pakaya namarupam, dependent on consciousness arises mentality materiality. The term nama here stands for the mental states, cetasika, in other words, the three mental groups, namely, feeling, vedanakandha, perception, sannakandha, and volitional or mental formations, sankarakandha. The so-called being, sata, saket sattva, is composed of five aggregates or groups, pankakandha, namely, physical body, feeling, perception, volitional formations, and consciousness, rupa, vedana, sanna, sankhara, and vinana. If consciousness is taken as the mind, then feeling, perceptions, and volitional formations are the concomitants or factors of that mind. Now when we say dependent on consciousness arises namarupa, mentality materiality, materiality means the physical body, its organs, faculties, and functions. Mentality means the factors of the mind mentioned above. In other words, vinanapakaya namarupam means dependent on consciousness arise the three mental concomitants, feeling, perception, and volitional formations, that compose mentality, along with the cognoscent material body in its first embryonic stage. Consciousness and its factors, siddhicetasika, are always interrelated and interdependent. Consciousness cannot arise and function independently of its factors, nor can the factors arise and function without consciousness. They arise simultaneously, sahajatapakaya, and have no independent existence. V. The sixfold base, salayatnayatna. Namarupapakaya salayatnam, dependent on mentality materiality arises the sixfold base, the five physical sense organs eye, ear, nose, tongue, and body and the mind base, manayatna. Manayatna is a collective term for the many different classes of consciousness, i.e. for the five kinds of sense consciousness and the many kinds of mind consciousness. Hence, five bases are physical phenomena, namely eye, ear, nose, tongue, and body, and the sixth, mind base, is identical with consciousness. 20. The function of vinana, consciousness, is varied. The third factor of the chain is made known to us as vinana. Now here again we hear of a sixth base, manayatana, which is identical with consciousness. But here by manayatana different types of consciousness are meant. It should be borne in mind that consciousness is not something that is permanent and everlasting. It undergoes change, not remaining the same for two consecutive moments. It comes into being and immediately passes away, yielding place to a new consciousness. These mental phenomena are, as it were, only the different aspects of those units of consciousness which, like lightning, every moment flash up and immediately thereafter disappear forever. 21. If there were no Namarupa, mentality materiality, no Salayatana, sixfold base, could arise. Because of Rupa, the physical sense organs, eye, ear, etc., appear, and because of Manayatana, different types of consciousness, the physical sense organs function. Thus Namarupa and Salayatana are inescapably interrelated and interdependent. 6. Contact, Fasa. Salayatana Pakaya Faso, dependent on the sixfold base arises contact. In the preceding proposition we saw the sixfold base or Ayatanas, eye, ear, etc. They are internal bases, Ajhataka Ayatana. External to one's material body, there are the corresponding five sense objects: form, sound, smell, taste, and tactile objects, and further, the mental objects. These are known as the six external bases, Bahira Ayatana. These external bases are food for our internal bases. Hence they are interrelated. Although there is this functional relationship between these six sense organs and their objects, awareness comes with vinana or consciousness. Hence it is said, if consciousness arises because of eye and forms, it is termed visual consciousness. Now when eye and forms are both present, visual consciousness arises dependent on them. Similarly with ear and sounds, and so on, down to mind and mental objects, ideas. Again, when the three, namely, eye, forms, and eye consciousness come together, it is their coincidence that is called contact, or impression. From contact there arises feeling, and so on. 22. Thus it is clear that contact, fasa, is conditioned by both the internal sixfold base, Ajhataka Ayatana, and the external sixfold base, Bahira Ayatana. In brief, dependent on the sixfold base arises contact or impressions, means, the visual contact conditioned by the eye, the sound contact conditioned by the ear, the smell contact conditioned by the nose, the taste contact conditioned by the tongue, the bodily contact conditioned by the body, the mental contact conditioned by the mind. 7. Feeling, Vedana. Fasa Pakaya Vedana, dependent on contact arises feeling. Feeling is sixfold: feeling born of visual contact, feeling born of sound contact, feeling born of smell contact, feeling born of taste contact, feeling born of body contact, and feeling born of mental contact. Feeling may be pleasurable, sukha, painful, dukkha, or neutral, i.e. neither pleasurable nor painful, adukkhamesukha equals upekha. As stated in the preceding clause, sense objects can never be cognized by the particular sensitivity without the appropriate kind of consciousness, but when these three factors come together, there arises contact. With the arising of contact, simultaneously there arises feeling, vedana, and it can never be stopped by any power or force. Such is the nature of contact and feeling. The experiencing of desirable or undesirable kama results of good and evil actions performed here or in a previous birth, is one of the prior conditions due to which feeling can arise. Seeing a form, hearing a sound, smelling an odor, tasting a flavor, touching some tangible thing, cognizing a mental object, idea. We experience feeling, but it cannot be said that all beings experience the same feeling with the same object. An object, for instance, which may be felt agreeable by one, may be felt unpleasant by another, and neutral by still another. Feeling also may differ in accordance with circumstances. A sense object which once evoked unpleasant feelings in us may possibly produce pleasant feelings in us under different circumstances. In a totally different background, geographical condition, climatic conditions, etc. Thus we learn how feeling is conditioned by contact. 8. Craving, tanha. Vedanapakaya tanha, dependent on feeling arises craving. Craving has its source, its genesis, its rise in feeling. All forms of appetite are included in tanha. Greed, thirst, desire, lust, burning, yearning, longing, inclination, affection, household love. These are some of the many terms that denote tanha, which in the words of the Buddha is the leader to becoming, bhavaneti. Becoming, which manifests as dukkha, as suffering, frustration, painful excitement, is our own experience. The enemy of the whole world is lust or craving, through which all evils come to living beings. Through clear understanding of craving, the origin of craving, the cessation of craving, the true way of practice leading to the cessation of craving, one disentangles this tangle. What then is craving? It is this craving which causes re-becoming, rebirth, accompanied by passionate pleasure, and finding fresh delight now here, now there, namely, craving for sense pleasures, kamatanha, craving for continued existence, for becoming, bhavatanha, and craving for non-existence, for self-annihilation, vibhavatanha. 23. Where does craving arise and take root? Where there is the delightful and the pleasurable, there craving arises and takes root. Forms, sounds, smells, tastes, bodily contacts, and ideas are delightful and pleasurable. There craving arises and takes root. 24. Craving, when obstructed by some cause, is transformed into wrath and frustration. From craving arises grief, from craving arises fear. To one free from craving there is no grief. Whence fear? 25. Man is always attracted by the pleasant and the delightful, and in his search for pleasure he ceaselessly runs after the six kinds of sense objects and clings to them. He little realizes that no amount of forms, sounds, smells, tastes, tangibles, and mental objects will ever satisfy the eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. In this intense thirst for either possessions or the gratification of desires, he gets bound to the wheel of samsara, is twisted and torn between the spokes of agony, and securely closes the door to final deliverance. The Buddha was most emphatic against this mad rush, and warned. Pleasure is a bond, a joy that's brief, of little taste, leading to drawn-out pain. The wise know that the hook is baited. 26. All mundane pleasures are fleeting, like sugar-coated pills of poison they deceive us, insidiously working harm. As stated above, whenever craving for these objects is connected with sensual pleasures, it is called sensuous craving. When it is associated with the belief in eternal personal existence, then it is called craving for continued existence. This is what is known as sasatadithi or eternalism. When craving is associated with the belief in self-annihilation at death, then it is called craving for self-annihilation, vibhavatanha. This is what is known as ukkitadithi or nihilism. Craving is conditioned not only by pleasurable and agreeable feelings, but by unhappy and unpleasant feelings, too. A man in distress craves and thirsts to get rid of it, and longs for happiness and release. To express it in another way, the poor and the needy, the sick and the disabled, in brief, all sufferers, crave for happiness, security, and solace. On the other hand, the rich, the healthy, who have not glimpsed the sufferings of the distressed, and who are already experiencing pleasure, also crave. They crave and long for more and more pleasures. Thus craving is insatiable. As cattle go in search of fresh pasture, so do people go in quest of fleeting pleasures, constantly seeking fuel for this life flame. Their greed is inordinate. All is burning, all is in flames. And what is the all that is in flames, that is burning? The five sense organs and the five sense objects are burning. Mind and thoughts are burning. The five aggregates of grasping, pankayupadanakandha, are burning. With what are they burning? With the fire of craving, with the fire of hate, with the fire of delusion. 27. A fire keeps burning so long as there is fuel. The more fuel we add, the more it burns. It is the same with the fire of life. Craving is an insatiable fire, and no fire is ever contented. Such is the nature of this corruption that spreads right up to the highest plane of existence, Bhavaga, with respect to spheres. And right up to the Gaudhavusiddha, the threshold of sainthood, with respect to mind flux. Where there is no self-desire, there indeed, is no sense-desire either, and where there is no self-desire there all ill dies out like a flame whose fuel is spent. It is only when suffering comes as its consequence, and not before, that one realizes the viciousness of this poisonous creeper of craving which winds itself round all who are not arahas or perfectly pure ones who have uprooted its taproot, ignorance. The more we crave, the more we suffer. Sorrow is the tribute we have to pay for having craved. Wherefore, know this craving as our foe here, in samsara, that guides us to continued and repeated sentient existence, and so builds the house of being. The Buddha, on attaining full enlightenment, spoke these joyful words. Repeated births are each a torment. Seeking but not finding the house builder. I wandered through many a samsaric birth. O house builder, thou art seen. Thou wilt not rebuild the house. All thy rafters have been shattered. Demolished has thy ridgepole been. My mind has now attained the unformed Nibbana. The extinction of craving is achieved. 28.